whole lot of ground to cover, and I need for you to listen fast, and I need for you to move when I say look at chapter 39. I need for you to be there, because we don't have much time to stop and wait. So Genesis, the first book in your Bible, today we're going to look at this important story. Probably remember Joseph had a coat of many colors. Made puppets of Joseph, and he told stories about that. His brothers, he had 11 brothers. His brothers sold him into slavery, and that's about all we know about that. I asked you to read chapters 37 through 50 this week. How many of you did that? Thank you. Look around. These are my pets. Yeah. So we're going to find out in this story that Jacob had a favorite. These are my favorites. So thank you for doing that. I think it's going to help as we do that. To quickly catch us up, Genesis is such an important book of the Bible. I love reading Genesis because it reads like a novel. It reads like a book. It just one family follows the next and the next with all kinds of stories and sub-stories. And it's just a fun book to read. We find in Genesis, the creation of heavens and earth, plants and animals, creation of man and woman. We see the impact of sin on God's creation. And for the first time, we see the wrath of God unleashed on his creation because of the presence of the wickedness and rebellion of man against God's perfect plan for his creation. There's lots of important things that happen in Genesis 1 and 36. And it would be well worth your time to go back and read those. Catches up to that. In chapter 15, God makes a covenant with a man named Abraham, declaring that this very old man who had no children would be the father of a great nation. He promises Abraham that his offspring would outnumber the stars in the sky. That was an incredible promise, considering his age and considering that he had no offspring. Yet Abraham believed that God counted it righteousness. So Abram had a son, Isaac. Isaac had a son, Jacob, who was also called Israel. Jacob had 12 sons, one of which is Joseph, who became, and these 12 sons became the fathers of the 12 tribes of Israel. These men are the very foundation of God's chosen people, and we follow their lives and the lives of their offspring throughout. That brings us to chapter 37. Hopefully you're open to chapter 37. As I mentioned before, Jacob, sometimes he's referred to as Israel in your scriptures, had 12 sons. And so Joseph had 11 brothers. And there's only one brother younger than Joseph who had been Benjamin. So Joseph was one of the younger ones. He was also the favorite son of Jacob. And there was no denying who the favorite son was. Jacob treated Joseph very much like the favorite. He was a very privileged young man in the order of his family. As a matter of fact, the coat that we learned so much about was just a symbol of Joseph being Jacob's favorite. So it may as well have been a target on his back. Brothers look at it because they knew where Joseph stood and where they stood in their father's eyes. So his brothers hated Joseph. binding sheaves in the field, and behold, the sheaf rode and stood upright, and behold, your sheep scattered around it and bowed down to my sheep. And his brother said to him, are you indeed to reign over us, or are you indeed to rule over us? So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. Look at verse 9. Secondly, then he dreamed another dream, and he told to his brothers, and he said, behold, I have dreamed another dream. Behold, the sun, the moon, the 11 stars were bowing down to me. So this dream implies that not only will his brothers bow down to him, but also his entire family, including his father. Just a side note here, if you have these kind of dreams, it may not be the greatest idea to share them with your family at the dinner table. So, let's move on to this story. One day Jacob's sons were out and attending to the flocks, and this is not a pasture just outside of the house. This is many, many miles away, days away from where their home place is. And so the 11 brothers or the 10 brothers are out, and they're attending to the flocks. And if we move down to verse 14, Jacob tells Joseph to go now and see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring me word. And then verse 18, and when they saw him coming from afar, and behold, he came near to them, and they conspired against him to kill. To make a long story short, instead of killing him, they decided to throw him in a pit, to hold him there until they could sell him into slavery. They would take his coat from him and tear it. They would dip it in goat's blood, and they would take it back to their father. And they would tell their father, we found this on the side of the road. This belongs to Joseph. Joseph must have been attacked by a wild animal. Joseph is dead. That's exactly what they do. And their father Jacob is greatly grieved. Brings us to chapter 38. 38 doesn't advance the story of Joseph at all. So we move to chapter 39. So meanwhile, Joseph is on the slave market in Egypt. And the Egyptian, he is bought by an Egyptian named Potiphar. And we learn in verse 1 of chapter 39, Potiphar is an important man. He's an officer of Pharaoh, a captain of the guard. Then in verse 2, we see the important declaration. The Lord was with Joseph. For a minute here, can you imagine how Joseph must have felt? He knew his brothers in life. But he was only doing what his father had asked him to do, right? He just went to check on them just like David had asked him to do. Now he finds himself betrayed by his brothers, thrown into this pit, sold into slavery. He's in Egypt. He's in a foreign land. And now he's a slave. So this statement of the Lord was with Joseph is important. Because often when bad things happen to us, when our circumstances are not good, we immediately think that God has left us. Where is God? You ever said that? When things are tough? Joseph understood that even in those things, God was with him. And so he served Potiphar faithfully. That's important. Look at verse 3. And Potiphar saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused that he did to succeed in his hands. And so he made him overseer of his house, and he put him in charge of all that he had. This is a critical turning point in Joseph's life. What if Joseph had said, God has forsaken me and gone into some presence that maybe there can't be a God or none of this stuff would have been happening? The story would have been right. But Joseph doesn't believe that. He said that even in this, I believe God is with me. And so he served God faithfully, and he serves Potiphar faithfully in the place that God has put him. Potiphar saw that God was with him and elevated Joseph to be in charge of everything in his house. Now, the story could have ended here. It seems that Joseph has been rewarded at a somewhat prominent position and a prominent home and a prominent land. But God's plan for Joseph lie with her, and Joseph flees, and as he runs away, she is left with Joseph's clothing in her hands. She kept clothing, showed it to Potiphar, and told him that Joseph had tried to rape her. Upon hearing this, Potiphar throws Joseph into prison. Again, Joseph finds himself betrayed and treated unjustly, all because he was being faithful to Potiphar. Faith to God, loving himself in a righteous manner. Did God abandon Joseph? Seems so. But look at verse 29, chapter 29, verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love. And we see a familiar pattern in verse 22. And God gave him favor with the keeper of the prison. And the keeper put Joseph in charge of all of the other prisoners. And the keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was under Joseph's charge because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it succeed. How would your outlook and your attitude in life be different if you believed that God was with you in every circumstance, in every situation? As believers, we have an eternal promise that God will never leave us. God will never forsake us in any circumstance. So Joseph is in prison. pay it. Joseph is over literally everyone in the kingdom except for Pharaoh. Look at chapter 41, verse 38. This proposal pleased Pharaoh and all of his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, "Can we find a man like this in whom is the Spirit of God? Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Since God has shown you all of this, there is none so discerning and as wise as you are. So you will be over our house, and all of my people shall order themselves as you command. Only as regards to the throne will I be greater than you." And Pharaoh says to Joseph, "See, I have set you over all of the land." Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand, and he clothed him with garments of fine linen, and he put on the gold chain around his neck, and he made him ride in the second chariot. And they called out before him, "Bow the knee." Thus he set him over all of the land of Egypt. Joseph had become the second most powerful man in Egypt behind only Pharaoh. So this is where the story is right now. Okay. Best of death comes. Just as God told Joseph there would be 7 years of tremendous abundance, it happened that way. And throughout Egypt, Joseph saw to it that all of the unused harvest was promptly stored in the storehouses and the bins and to prepare for the upcoming famine. Just as God had said 7 years of abundance, God summoned a famine on the land. Thanks to the diligent work of Joseph, Egypt had more than enough food to feed its people. The lands around Egypt, however, quickly ran out of food, and they began to travel to Egypt to buy food. Verse 56. So when the famine had spread over all of the land, Joseph opened all of the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in the land of Egypt. Moreover, all of the earth came to Egypt to Joseph to buy grain, because the famine was severe all over the earth. This is where we get a glimpse of God's plan. Some of you, I had a grandmother who did tapestries. Some of you do that. As a child, I remember sitting at her feet and seeing the backside of that tapestry. And it just looked like chaos, right? And there were strings going out every direction, and it made no sense. Well, this is a time where God is working in tapestry, and every once in a while, He flips it over and shows you the other side and all of the chaos. Where God gives us just a brief flash of His greater plan. Back in Canaan, Joseph's family is starving and having food. Jacob sends all but his youngest son Benjamin to Egypt to buy some grain. And when they arrive, Joseph immediately recognizes his brothers, but he does not reveal his identity. Remember, he's wearing all this horrible stuff, so they may not have recognized. Probably advance with their heads down from the water. This is better than so. Look at 42, verse 6. Now Joseph was governor over all the land, and he was the one who sold all the people of the land. And Joseph's brothers came and bowed themselves before him, and their faces were on the ground. Joseph saw his brothers and recognized them, and he treated them like strangers and spoke roughly. "Where did you come from?" he said. And they said, "From the land of Canaan to buy food." And Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. And Joseph remembered the dreams that he had dreamed about them. Chapters 42 through 44 is a story within itself. Joseph tests his brothers and sends them back to Canaan several times to get the younger brother to make them answer questions about their life. And it's this whole testing process that Joseph is trying to get a feel for who their brothers have become, to see if they've changed at all, to maybe even to see if they're sorry for what they have done to him. But at this point, they still don't know who he is, but he knows who they are. And so these three chapters, 42, 43, and 44, are happy that her brother's alive, or may be afraid that Joseph would seek his revenge. But he greeted verse 4. So Joseph said to his brothers, "Come near to me, please." And they came near, and he said, "I'm your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now, do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in this land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not he who sent me here, but God." God sent me before you to preserve life, to provide for you a remnant on earth and keep you alive. You did not send me here. God sent me here. Do you see the grace and the forgiveness that Joseph has given to a group of guys that absolutely does not deserve it? How could he act in this way? This group of guys hated Joseph so much that they conspired and planned to kill him. They wanted him gone, and now their lives and the lives of their families are at the very mercy of the one that they treated so unjustly. If you were Joseph, what would you do? How would you react if you were lost? Let me take you out of that situation, in those circumstances of this particular story, and say, how do you respond when you were unjustly treated? How have you responded when you've been unjustly treated? Does rage and revenge burn within you? Does grace and forgiveness even cross your mind? Do you even once consider that God may be working through your pain and your misery to accomplish something far greater than you can even imagine? John Piper said this, and I'm going to say this a couple times. God takes the very sins of the destroyers, and he makes them the means of the destroyers. God takes the very sins of the destroyers, and he makes them the means of the destroyers' deliverance. So following this confession of his identity to his brothers, Joseph sends his brothers back to Canaan to get his father and to get their families and to bring them to live in Egypt, where they would all be protected from the devastation of famine. When they arrive in Egypt, Pharaoh gives Joseph a place to settle his family and all of the possessions and all of their land, animals, and in the land of Goshen. This is found in chapter 47, verse 11. Then Joseph settled his father and his brothers and gave them possessions of the land and the best of the land and the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded. And Joseph provided his father and his brothers and his father's household with food and work. Well, time passes. Joseph's father dies, and as this event takes place, this becomes, and some may say, this is one of the more important parts of this story that takes us to chapter 50. Jacob has died, and look at verse 15. Joseph's brothers are now afraid. Now the dad is dead. Joseph will get us. Right? They knew that would break their father's heart. So Joseph may just be waiting for their father to die. So look at verse 15, chapter 15. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "Maybe Joseph will pay us back for all the people that we did to him." So they sent a message to Joseph saying, "Your father gave this command before he died. Say to Joseph, please forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin because they did evil to you. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, "Behold, we are your servants. out that many people should be kept alive as they are today. So do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones. Thus he comforted him, and he spoke kindly to him. So why is this story important? Why take the time to go through it? The first reason is that the move of God's chosen people from Canaan to Egypt was all part of God's great plan for the salvation of his people. If you go back to that covenant I spoke about in chapter 15, we see that God told Abraham, he said that this was going to happen. What had just happened was going to happen. I think this will be on the screen, but Genesis 15, verse 13. This is what God tells Abraham. Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and will be servants there, and they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nations that they serve, and afterwards they shall come out with great possessions. As for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace, and shall be buried in a good old age, and they shall come back here in the fourth generation. For the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. God's people, the offspring of Abraham, would be sojourners in a land that is not theirs. That sound like a promise being fulfilled in the story of Joseph? Is it random that God's chosen people are being moved from Canaan to Egypt? This promise also says that his people will be afflicted for 400 years. 400 years. That's quite a way to start off a relationship. This is hard for us to wrap our hands around. Just to help put that number in perspective, next month, America will celebrate its 242nd year in existence. So 400 years is a very, very long time. The 400-year period of affliction begins when Jacob moves his family into Egypt. So this is the start of that 400 years that God told me. So there's a plan for his pilgrim people. It's a picture of his life on this earth until heaven. It's a picture of our life on earth until heaven. If God planned 400 years of affliction for his people before the promised land, we should not be surprised that he says to us in Acts 14, through many tribulations you must enter into the kingdom of God. So let me just real quickly say, why 400 years? Why didn't God just give the Israelites the land right then? And God answers that question in verse 16 when he says that the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. Let me explain that for just a second really quickly. Instead of giving them that, God is allowing 400 years of sin and rejection and immorality to pile up so that when Joshua comes back to those lands to take those lands 400 years later, that this promise will be fulfilled. Because of their wickedness, God will drive them from her. So that's the second part of that promise to God. I think there's a second reason why this story of Joseph is important. What God meant for evil, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. Thinking back to that verse in chapter 15, God had a purpose in everything, even the bad things, overriding what others meant to be for his good purpose. The slavery to Potiphar's house led to false accusations, which led to prison, which led to forgetting, which led to Pharaoh, which led to a problem, from which Joseph was saved God's people. God was as much in the pit and the prison as he was in the palace. Each stage of the journey was a necessary part of the end. But in the middle of it all, Joseph couldn't see it. It wasn't until the very end that he could see it. Some parts of Jesus you can only know through your pain. Sometimes your pain enables you to minister to others in that. does show you how we are the path of God's salvation in the world involves suffering. God didn't save the nation of Israel despite Joseph's suffering, but because of the way people will hear about Jesus' wounds will often be through our wounds. We have this idea that the abundant life is about slowly moving toward comfort and ease and luxury, away from suffering and stress and worry, and occasionally sacrifices we are asked to bear. None of this is true. It doesn't matter who says it, and it doesn't matter how nice their smile is when they say it. Jesus says, if you're going to come after me, you have to take up the cross. It's through our suffering that God brings life into the world. So ask again, how would your life change if you believed that in everything God was with you? That he had been with you the whole time. For Joseph, the men that just served God, and didn't get killed. He didn't despair. Wherever he was, he applied himself and he asked himself, what does it look like to serve God here? He must have more you learned through grace. Do not fear, I will provide for you and your little ones. Because he knew that God had a good plan. Salvation not only of Joseph, but of Joseph's brothers too. He was able to extend grace as God had ordained. There's a third point. I think that this is the most important point in this story. If you'll turn over to chapter 49. Come back to chapter 49. Chapter 49, we see in this first verse. Jacob has this great Jacob dies, he's dying. He gathers his 12 sons together. And he says this in chapter 49, verse 1. And Jacob called his sons and he said, gather yourselves together, and I will tell you what shall happen to you in the days to come. And he gives this prophetic blessing to each son in the vision. The most important blessing that he gives. Jacob gives to his son is not to his favorite son Joseph, but it's to his Joseph's brother, Judah, or Satan. Judah, your brother shall praise you, your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies, your father's son shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's cub from the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down, he crouched as a lion. And as a lion, who dare rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from his feet, until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of his people. It is in this prophecy, it is in these two verses, that we see that the story of Joseph is not about Joseph at all. This whole story is about Jesus coming. Here is a prophecy of the coming final king of Israel, the Lion of Judah, the Messiah. Notice in verse 10 that the scepter, the ruler's staff, the sign of the king, will be in the Lion of Judah until one comes who is no ordinary king, because all of the peoples, not just Israel, will obey him. To him shall be the obedience of all people, the people. This is fulfilled in Jesus. Listen to the way John uses the same language in Revelation. Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered, so that he can open the scrolls and the seven seals. And they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open the seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people from God. Every tribe, language, people, nation, and you have made them a king and a priest to our God, and they shall reign over all of the earth. This is the good news of the gospel for people who believe. God, through Joseph, saw to it that the covenant that he made with Abraham and his people would not be broken. He provided a way for his chosen people, Israel, to describe the famine, thus preserving the line of Judah, which could ultimately would be the line that Jesus would be born. Without Jesus, there is no salvation. Without Jesus, there is no forgiveness of sin. Without Jesus, there is no other way for us. Without a relationship with the Father, we have to have Jesus. So God's plan for salvation for his people is hinged on the sword and the cross of the Jew. Now we can hear Jesus saying what Joseph said to his brothers. God sent me before you to preserve life, your life, my life. Not just to provide shelter, aid during the famine, as Joseph did, to preserve us for the eternal life. And God, if God in his wisdom and power can orchestrate all the tales, twists, turns, sin, and betrayal of this story, will ultimately make it work for good, why do we not trust him? Why do we not trust him in our lives and allow him as he pleases with our lives? He has promised that he will never leave us, and he will never forsake us. What would change about your life today if you really believe God is with you? How would your attitude change toward what has happened in your past? Who would you forgive? Are you working now in the situation that you're in as if it were in time? Can you rejoice even in the broken places in your life, knowing that they are there for a purpose? Maybe the purpose is to know better, to demonstrate your strength more than others. Maybe you could have been in that valley of your life, those points of misery and pain, so that you could grab him and another brother or sister that's walking through the same paths. Can you kiss the wounds which have made you weak, knowing that they came from the Savior who died, sits on the throne, and promises that just like he was resurrected from the dead, he promises to work all things for good? Father, we do thank you for the time to open the word. In the twists and turns of the stories and the many ways that we can interpret it, sometimes when we stop and we don't see the entire story as a whole. But Lord, sometimes we don't see the purpose. God, we thank you that you provided Joseph. We thank you that you sent him ahead of his family. We thank you for the lives that saved because he was with you. Lord, we thank you that today we sit in this place because the line of Judah was preserved. We sit in this place because of those faithful people in your good and gracious and faithful plan that we have the opportunity God bless you.